Hello and welcome to 5 Minutes Postgres. My name is Lucas and today we're going to talk about how to avoid deadlocks in Postgres migrations and surprising lock behavior with migrations that I personally encountered. To start with, this is a blog post by Vanessa on Dovetail Engineering blog. The first thing that she describes here is the issue that you can run into when you have a migration that does two different changes and then you have parts of your workload that conflict with it. So imagine you have a migration where you're altering the RLS policy on one table, and you're also altering a different table where you're adding a constraint. These are related in principle, and so it kind of makes sense to do this one migration. But the issue is that you might have a user running a request like this, where they're doing a select from the common table and a select from the common thread table within one transaction. The important thing to note here is that these are essentially reversed in terms of order. So the migration first does the change on the common thread table and then changes the common table versus the queries run the other way around. If you're unlucky and that second transaction runs at the same time as the migration, you will get a deadlock. So as Vanessa describes here, first process A will take an access share lock on the common table. Then process B, running the migration, will take an access exclusive lock on the common thread table. And then process A will also try to get a lock on the same table, but it will not be able to get its access share lock because that table is currently exclusively locked. Now, unfortunately, also process B cannot proceed because it wants to get an access exclusive lock on the common table, but that's already locked with an access share lock by the transaction. And so at that point, there's no way to resolve this without canceling one of these two. Now, the good news is that Postgres has what's called the deadlock detector. And so behind the scenes, the deadlock detector runs by default once a second, and it will check for these type of problems in the lock graph. And it will essentially say, better than life locking and just waiting forever, let's cancel one of those two processes. And so that will resolve the situation, and then things will continue. Of course, that means that your application may need to issue a retry either on the migration or on the transaction that was canceled. Other ways to improve the situation are, for example, in a migration, if you have different tables involved, it often makes sense to not do too much at once in the same transaction. Even though it's nice to have transactional DDL in Postgres, in production workloads that often causes these type of problems. And so one best practice that is described here is to split the migration so that it's once for each table, and then you avoid potential deadlocks because of the different tables involved. Now, the other thing that's useful to do sometimes is to look at which locks are being acquired by your migration, because you might have more complex relationships. And so one thing you can do is, before you issue a commit on a migration, you can look at the PG locks table, which shows you the internal view of Postgres's lock manager. You can just look which locks are currently held. And this gets everything, which you could also just get that for the current PID, but already did the work, it just didn't commit the transaction, because the locks would only be released at the end of the transaction. So it's a good way to get a sense for which locks you actually need to complete the work. Now, the other thing that Vanessa recommends here is being explicit about your lock order. And I think it's also described here very clearly that this is actually hard to do in practice. Unfortunately, most of the time when you have application engineers making changes, it's unlikely that they will be aware of the locking considerations the database has to take. And so really, this is where splitting things up makes it easier, because then you don't have to be conscious of these different orders. And so I think, to me, this means that the big call to action here is to avoid complex transactions. Complex transactions, unless you truly need them, usually make things worse in the database rather than better. And so unless you really need that atomicity guarantee, it's much better to have work split into multiple parts that are not part of the same transaction, because then you don't have to worry about the ordering as much. The last thing that Vanessa mentions here is that it's good to link your database migrations. At Dovetail internally, they have a tool to analyze the statements. It's not mentioned here which tool that is, but personally in the Ruby on Rails world, one tool that I've seen frequently used is Strong Migrations by Andrew Kane. This will run as part of your Ruby on Rails migration, and it will check for a few known cases where your migrations might be doing something unsafe. And so then it prompts an engineer explicitly that they're intentionally doing something risky, like making a very slow operation that will lock the whole table for a long time. Now, on that last note, I want to show you something that I personally find surprising when I write migrations on a Postgres database. And so for that, I'm just going to pull my local database here. And I'll illustrate this by first showing you how we want things to work. I'm intentionally running this query very slow. So this is a pgsleep 60, but it's also doing a count. What I'm illustrating here is a long-running query that's on this users table here that we're working with. Now, in parallel, I'm also doing a completely unrelated read on, for example, my own email address. I'm just getting my own user ID. And as expected, that's really fast. 2 milliseconds, just got the data, it's a single row, super simple. This is what we would expect. They're two independent operations, so there's no reason why one should block the other. Now, I'm running this DDL statement where I'm adding a column to a table. And in Postgres, that's generally a very fast operation because I'm just modifying the catalogs to add that extra column. I don't have to add any data to the table for this. This is a nullable field, and so Postgres just assumes that there is no data in the table for this by default. I'll start this. You'll notice that this is not fast. Now, because I'm concurrently running this count query, that makes it slow because I can't rewrite the table whilst the query is happening. The thing that's really surprising, if I go back here, you'll notice how the query that was really fast earlier is now really slow. And this is what oftentimes would cause production issues, because what's happening is you have a DDL statement that's really fast, but it's blocked because this DDL statement here was blocked by this other activity here. And so until this slow query here finished, the DDL statement couldn't finish. And so any other activity on the table was also blocked, because in Postgres, this very simple select statement here was behind the DDL statement in a lock queue. And so Postgres intentionally doesn't let you run that really fast select query. The table is not yet actually exclusively locked. It's just somebody requested an exclusive lock. And so because you have that request for an exclusive lock from the DDL statement, you also get other selects slowed down. If you're seeing surprising behavior like this, where you're making a really simple migration, you're just adding a column, and for some reason, A, it's very slow, and B, your whole production application is down. Oftentimes what happens is that the true root cause of the problem is that you have a slow query on that table, or a long-running transaction on that table, and that's causing the issue. Now, one last note. On production systems, it makes a lot of sense to set the statement timeout. You can also, in newer Postgres versions, set an idle transaction timeout. If you have that in place, that also means if your statement timeout is 1 minute, your migration will at most be blocked for 1 minute. That might still show some impact if there's slow queries, but at least we're not talking 30 minutes or 60 minutes. Sometimes I've seen runaway queries or stuck processes cause bad problems. Statement timeout and idle transaction timeout really help you avoid that problem. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.